Hey guys, it's Dr. May. Hope you're doing good today. We have a really cool lesson. This one is all about building connections with others and learning about our proximity seeking styles. And it really varies depending on what attachment style we had and what earlier experiences we had. And we can learn healthier ways to reach out to people to foster better and healthier connections. So that's what today's lesson is all about. Really useful stuff. So I hope you'll join me. Here we go. All right. Connecting with others, proximity seeking actions. All right, here we go. So what are proximity seeking actions, right? So proximity seeking actions are initially seen when we're babies, when we're children. And they're designed, we're wired up to have these to help bring our caregivers closer to us because we need caregivers to survive, especially when we're babies and little children. But we continue with proximity seeking actions as we grow throughout our life because we always need relationships. And they basically break this down into two sections, okay? So the first one is called signaling behavior. So think of a little baby who doesn't really have very much many capabilities yet because the baby is so small. So what does the baby do? The baby could do things such as cry, such as have certain facial expressions or eye contact or fussing or kind of small motions designed to help spur the caregiver on to come closer. Okay, so it's kind of a signal that the baby gives off to bring the caregiver closer to him or her so that, the caregiver could stay around. And sometimes usually as the motor skills develop, they also do things such as reach out or hold on to the caregiver or even pull at the caregiver to come closer. Okay, so there's some motor actions involved with that as well. Later, as the kid gets older and can start to walk, the child is actually able to bring him or herself closer to the caregiver. So he or she could crawl over or run over or jump on the parent's lap or cling or say, no, don't put me down, right? And things like that. So they can use more of their motor skills to get closer to the attachment figure, okay? All right, so another really important category of proximity seeking is just about eye contact, okay? And as we know, like the eyes are the windows of the soul, right? And we could communicate a lot just through our eyes. And sometimes we can look at someone in such a way that they get the message that we want them to come closer. Or we could look at people in such a way that they get the message to back off, or that we love them, or that we can't stand them. Like our eyes really convey a lot. And all parents have different styles of eye contact and convey different things to their children through their eye contact. So for example, right? Some parents might have an excessive need for eye contact with their kids. Like it might feel like too much, like overwhelming. You know how when someone stares at you and it feels almost intrusive, like it's really uncomfortable. So sometimes, you know, a parent might look too hard or too intensely at the child and the child feels violated by that kind of eye contact. On the other extreme, some parents don't do much eye contact at all. Maybe they have their own issues and they're uncomfortable. And so they don't have enough eye contact with the child and it could feel kind of rejecting or neglectful from the child's point of view. Maybe like I'm not worthy of being attended to or looked at. Other times there could actually be a negative intention with the eye contact, like that look of disapproval or that look of like disgust, like, oh, you know, look at you, look what you're doing, you know, or God, I'm so disappointed in you. Oh, you know, and so the child takes that away and feels really bad about him or herself and a sense of shame, a sense of like, I'm unworthy, I'm being judged, I'm not okay as I am. And so when I grow up, I might be afraid to look into people's eyes because I might be afraid to find that same painful type of rejection. Okay, so now I want to move on to how our proximity seeking styles develop based on the way our childhood went, right? Because everything starts back when we're young and becomes an implicit memory that we carry on into our life, into adulthood. Okay, so we're going to start with when things go well. So secure attachment, right? So secure attachment is the ideal. That's, you know, the healthiest style of connecting with our caregivers and then also relating with other significant people in our lives into adulthood. Okay, so a good enough parent, notice I didn't say a perfect parent, a good enough parent, right? Shows his or her care and protection by responding sensitively and affectionately to the baby with their own proximity seeking behaviors, right? So the parent shows the child that, let's say she wants to be close to the child. She wants to be there to attend to the child's needs, right? She wants to learn more about the child and soothe the child when needed or play with the child. And so the child walks away with positive messages, right? That, you know what, others do want to be near me. You know, it feels good when people come close to me because they want to attend to me. And that's something I want to keep going into my life, right? So let's look at the examples on the bottom. So if a baby's distressed, the parent will more often than not respond in a sensitive way. You know, like in the picture, the mother picks up the baby, she tries to soothe him, maybe with her actions, the rocking, the voice, maybe comforting movements, stroking his or her back, right? So the child might feel like when I'm upset, people understand that they want to help me. They want to be there for me. Okay, so in the future, I might trust that that's going to still happen. Okay, the next one is if the child is happy, if the child is in a good mood, people still want to be close to me, right? They want to play with me. They want to, you know, play with me, have loving touch with me, maybe gaze fondly at me or tousle my hair or something like that. So I could be in a good mood or I could be in a cranky mood, but people still want to be around me and be there for me, right? What a powerful message to take away. Okay, so here's some of the positive after effects that would happen if we're lucky enough to have that kind of a childhood, right? So we're gonna, because we had positive experiences reaching out and our proximity seeking was responded to well, we know how to reach out to other people. You know, we have inborn implicit memories of physical behaviors that successfully get closest for us. You know, we know how to make the right kind of eye contact or reach out to people or use appropriate touch to keep people close to us or draw people close to us, okay? And then we also trust that people will be responsive to us more often than not, that there's a good chance people will be sensitive to my needs because that had been my early experience. And so I don't feel funny about seeking proximity. I don't have any issues around it. I could love cleanly, as they sometimes say, and I could unambivalently seek and receive soothing and comfort from others, okay? And another thing is that because we trust that this will happen most of the time, if the person's not available for me, I'm not gonna freak out about it. I could understand and respond okay if someone can't be with me all the time that I want them to. I could be more patient with it and understanding, and I could maybe, you know, amuse myself while the other person's busy. So in that picture, for example, let's say, you know, the woman's doing her work and the guy's sweeping the floor and they're not interacting right now, but it's okay. Maybe later we'll get back to it, right? So I could still regulate myself and be okay, even if the other person's not around. So when all of these things are in place, when I know how to ask people to come closer, when I trust that they're going to be there for me, and when I can tolerate them being more distant, it tends to make for a healthier relationship, right? I'm more likely to, you know, have a smoother interaction with others, especially those close to me in my life, okay? So if you're not at this point, don't worry about it, but this is kind of like the goal to keep in mind. We can work toward an earned secure attachment and developing these capabilities. Okay, so if you're watching this video, chances are your upbringing might have been a little more challenging. But that's okay, but let's understand it better. Okay, so the first one, we're gonna talk about the anxious-ambivalent attachment style and how that impacts proximity in our childhood, okay? So anxious-ambivalent attachment, basically what that means is sometimes the caregiver is really appropriate and close and available, but other times they're not, or they're critical, or they're not, or not around when you need them. So there's an unpredictability to the caregiver. So when things are good, I don't know how long it's going to last. I don't know when it's going to end. I don't know if it's going to come around again. And it's hard for me to trust it because it is inconsistent. Okay. And there might be, you know, sometimes intrusion from the parent as well. So closeness, I get a little intrusive too, and it may not always feel good. Sometimes it feels really good. Sometimes it doesn't feel really good. Okay. So in this situation, there's some patterns of proximity-seeking behaviors that are common, okay? Proximity-seeking behaviors, so your tendency to reach out for people becomes increased, overactive, or frantic, okay? So if I think I'm gonna lose it, or I can't, I don't know when else my parents gonna be around except for right now, I might furiously seek that attachment because I have, it's almost like if there's food today, but I don't know the next time there's gonna be food, I might eat today and stock up because I don't know when the food's coming around again, okay? So it's just like that with love, like you're seeking it so much and it's like, if it's here today, I better stock up because I don't know when it's coming around again, you know? So there's much more attention on getting the relationship, securing the relationship, keeping the relationship, clinging to what you got because it's unpredictable, okay? And there's more focus on keeping a relationship than there is on exploration and being your own person. You're more preoccupied with the other person, okay? So in adulthood, this is called preoccupied attachment, whereas in childhood, it's anxious ambivalent attachment, but the preoccupation with the other is still very present. All right, but back to the children. So the child might have to fight for the attention needed and struggle to maintain it, okay? They may be unable to relax into the feeling of being connected and comforted, even when the caregiver responds positively, right? Because you don't know when it's gonna disappear, right? The child may become preoccupied with the emotional and physical availability of others and interpret boundaries as rejection and unavailability, okay? So you have a much harder time dealing with separation than somebody who's a secure attachment person, right? Secure attachment people, when you believe people are gonna be around for you, you really trust that their intentions are good and they're gonna respond to you as much as they can. It's okay if they wanna do their own thing. I don't need you all the time, I'll figure it out. But if it's just a little bit and drips and drops, it's like, if you're separating from me, it feels terrible, right? So I'm much more likely to be preoccupied with abandonment, right? How many people have abandonment fears, all right? This is your story here. Okay, so now in adulthood, you still are gonna have this implicit memory, this body memory of this desperate reaching out. So you might tend to reach out to certain significant people in your life in an intense, eager, clingy, need-driven way. You might lean forward, have your arms straight out, you know, beseech with your eyes, like that kind of neediness, gaze with your eyes, okay? Again, you're still gonna have difficulty with separation and distance. Let's say you have a partner, your partner needs to go on a business trip for the weekend, you might really get upset about that. Or you're hoping to spend the whole night together, but he needs to spend a couple hours working. And now it feels like a rejection, okay? It might be really, really hard to accept separation from others, okay? Might be panicked or inconsolable when someone leaves or wants time to themselves, okay? You want to, your urge is to merge, interpret differentness as rejection, right? Does this desire to be the same? And if we're different, it feels like, oh my God, like, what does that mean? We're not together anymore, right? You also might end up doing some crisis calls, calling people in crisis just to bring them closer. Like, you know, if I'm really feeling terrible, please help me, right? So this is your cry for help defense mechanism coming in. Remember that from a while ago, right? Fight, flight, cry for help are mobilized defenses, okay? This is the cry for help defense here. Okay. So now we're going to move on to anxious avoidant attachment and how that impacts proximity, okay? So anxious avoidant, think you're somebody who ends up avoiding relationships because they were so painful and because your needs weren't attended to. So if you went to your caregiver with need, with vulnerability, with shame or sadness or weakness or hurt or need, and your caregiver ignored it, or made you feel bad about it, or invalidated you, or punished you in some way, you're gonna eventually learn that it's not worth it to reach out to people because it's just gonna create pain. Yeah, and my needs are not gonna be attended to. So the adaptation is to say, you know what, forget other people. I'm just gonna do this by myself. I'm just gonna not need other people and I'm gonna take care of it and I'm gonna do auto-regulation. I'm gonna try to soothe my own self without having to rely on unreliable people, okay? So I'm more likely to explore the environment and do my own thing and be much less preoccupied with the relationships. Okay. So I might, with proximity, not even bother to reach out. I might abandon reaching out types of motions or body language where I'm beseeching other people because it didn't lead for good results for me when I was growing up. Okay. So that's the implicit memory that's carried through in my life now. Okay. So in adulthood. Okay. So here's the body language. So I might just sometimes just, you know, shut down, not make eye contact, look away, pull away, kind of lean away, tighten away. And if I do reach out, it's not like a very comfortable reaching out. I might reach out halfway, my elbow at my side, or like with a stiff arm, or with my palm not quite out, maybe turned away or turned down. So it's not a really free reaching out. It's much more of an inhibitive reaching out because I have these early feelings of it's not going to be worth it. People aren't going to reach back. People aren't going to look back. My needs aren't going to be attended to. Okay. So it makes sense adaptively. It's made sense given my upbringing. Okay. So essentially, like it says in the second part here, I may not be expecting a response or might expect a negative response if I even try to reach out. Okay. So the things you might be thinking, examples, just a few examples, is I want a relationship because maybe there's still a part of you that does, right? But I can't reproach people. You know, I can't look them in the eye. I can't carry out a conversation. I didn't even bother going out of my apartment this weekend. I just kind of stayed to myself. I can't come out of my shell. You know, you kind of give up on it. It's like part of you might want to, but part of you just doesn't think it's going to happen for you. Okay. The loneliness involved. And you might also, as things start to get close, you might have a fear, secret fear come up and then try to create distance in order to like prevent yourself from getting too close and getting hurt. And you may not do this consciously. Like you might just kind of like, you know, end up doing some things that create a rift in the relationship when it gets too close and kind of like sabotage because you're, you know, it's going to be too vulnerable and it's just going to lead to hurt because that's what's happened in my life. All right. So now, disorganized, disoriented attachment. Okay. So this one's most associated with trauma, with complex PTSD, with ongoing chronic relational invalidation. Okay. So this is when your parents were frightened or frightening to you when you were a child. They weren't able to respond appropriately to your needs. When you tried to reach out to them, they didn't respond in an organized, appropriate, responsive manner. And so nearness to them was associated with danger and threat, right? So we're wired up to want to reach to a caregiver for care, for help, for soothing, right? So we still have that inner drive. But when the caregiver is frightened or frightening, another drive kicks in, and that's our animal defenses. So while we're reaching out, there's a simultaneous activation of like a fight, flight, freeze, fold, collapse response. And so there's a push-pull happening at the same time. Okay, so as it says in the bottom, you know, there's an attachment. So you want to reach out and get close. And at the same time, you want to push away or you want to fight. Okay, and you might notice this happening in your life now. And sometimes, you know, people don't realize that there's some disorganization in their attachment style until they start to seek a partner in adulthood. And all of a sudden, these things kind of come up. So you're trying to get close to somebody, but there's a fear that comes up and you automatically feel like you're pulling away. Or you end up picking a fight with somebody and getting nasty, even though part of you really wants to get close to that person. Or you might find yourself kind of like freezing up or collapsing as you get closer to a person and you just don't know why. But this might be the key to why, you know, because this was your earlier experience, because attachment and proximity seeking was associated with threat in some way. Okay. More extreme, you know, case, it might've been abuse, you know, or someone being nice to you because they're only grooming you for abuse. So that closeness had like an evil intent to it, you know? So it makes sense most likely why you're having a hard time reaching out to people now. All right. Another thing might happen too, is kind of like I was mentioning for avoidant attachment, the fear might kick in and you might end up relationship that's getting too close because there's a fear that comes up. You know, if I get too close, it's going to be dangerous, right? So the flight response could even be ending the relationship in addition to the more subtle, just pulling away or, you know, kind of things like that. Okay. All right. But when we're trying to, it helps, you know, to identify what my style is, or what my predominant style is based on the attachment things we just talked about. But it's important also to know that as I try to heal these things, that proximity seeking and boundaries go hand in hand. Okay. There were two other videos about boundaries, right, for sensory motor psychotherapy that you could also refer to about how to identify safe boundaries, how to set boundaries using your body, and so forth. But you're not going to be able to reach out very easily unless you're more confident that you could set a boundary. So there's a reaching and a stopping at the same time. And sometimes needing being able to do both is exactly what you need in order to get close in a safer way. Okay. So you need to know that if I get close to someone, I can still protect myself, you know, and that I'll be able to control the process of getting close and pulling away. And it's not going to be out of my control, which it very well might have been when growing up. Okay. All right. So we have some exercises to help with this process of developing a healthier proximity seeking style. Okay. So the first thing is I'm going to go over a variety of proximity seeking actions with you just to increase your awareness. And we're going to file this away and use this for the next exercise. Okay. So keep these in mind. You can always go back and take notes or rewatch the video here so that you could use these for the next exercise. Okay. So here's some examples. So to seek proximity, we could use our facial expression, right? There's inviting open facial expressions, a smile, the way we look at someone with our eyes, our eyebrow wags, as we talk about in radically open DBT, appropriate eye contact where we're kind of communicating with our eyes that we want to get closer to somebody. Okay. We could even use our voice. So there's certain kinds of voice tones, volumes, and voice qualities that give the message that we want to get closer to somebody. Okay. And it could vary from come here to get over here, right? But both of them are seeking proximity. Okay. But it depends on the situation. All right. So how do we modulate our voice in order to get people to come closer? Okay. There's other kinds of body language, such as like a kind of flirty, kind of like tilting your head to one side, or maybe leaning forward a little when someone's talking to you, turning your body toward the person, having a relaxed, open body posture. Okay. Other times we can literally reach out with our hand and make a beckoning motion. Like the woman in the picture is kind of like literally asking someone to come closer by using her hand gesture. Okay. You could literally move closer to somebody by sitting or standing closer to them. You could make a verbal request for proximity that's either direct or indirect. You know, an indirect might be, hey, I have something on my phone. Come here, check this out, right? It's kind of like an indirect request that brings somebody a little closer to me, okay? If it's appropriate, I might hug, touch, shake hands with somebody, pat someone on the back, lean on somebody, you know, things like that. In certain situations, my vulnerability might bring someone closer. So if I show somebody that I'm in distress, you know, maybe I need help because I've gone through something or I'm feeling a certain way today and I could use your help or comfort. There's ways of me conveying that through my body language, through showing my emotions more openly. Sometimes I could offer something to somebody that they need or want, and that brings them closer. So in the picture, maybe the girl needs help from her grandfather, or maybe he really wants the soup that she's making, and so he comes closer. Maybe I had something to give somebody and it brings them closer, okay? Other times, in a more negative way, I guess you could say, depending on the situation, you could intimidate, coerce, or blame other people to get them to come closer to you, right? Because anger is an approach emotion. You know, so if you kind of provoke somebody, they may be like, oh yeah, and start walking up to you, right? So that's another, you know, way to do it. Maybe not the way you always want to do it, but it's still a way, right? Okay, So now that we have those in mind, okay, as examples, the exercise is going to be, so for the next few days or however long you feel like you'd want to do this, just try to notice throughout your day which proximity seeking actions you make when you're in relationships, interacting with different people throughout your day, okay? So take note of that. If you want to jot it down in a journal, you know, periodically throughout the day, or, you know, make notes on your phone or something so you can keep track of it, all right? Then you could also use some observation and kind of look around at other people and notice what proximity seeking actions they make. Like what now that you're more aware of this, what are you noticing in other people that they do to bring people closer? Okay. And you know, think about what your reaction is to seeing them doing that. Okay. And for yourself, think about what you might have learned by your own proximity seeking actions. What does it tell you about yourself, or maybe even about your history? Okay. And then after you evaluate all these things, think of which proximity seeking actions do you want to explore more? Like maybe there's something on the previous three slides that you're not too familiar with, you haven't done too much yet, and maybe you want to try to add it to your repertoire to see how it feels. So maybe, like, you know, give certain things a try and, you know, check in with yourself to see if it feels right for you. Okay. So this exercise is called reaching out. It's very interesting. The pictures I got directly from the sensory motor psychotherapy textbook, because I wanted it to be, you know, exactly what they had in mind. And I didn't want to get a picture on the internet that didn't quite capture it. So there's six different styles of reaching out that are illustrated here, okay? So for each one, you want to imitate it and then hold the position for a little bit and just notice how it impacts your building blocks, such as, when I do this, how do I feel? What emotions come up? What thoughts come through my mind? You know, what body sensations am I experiencing? Okay. Does it feel familiar or unfamiliar? Or do I know anybody that tends to reach out like this? Does it remind me of someone? Okay. Or if I were reaching out this way to somebody, what might it be conveying to them? Or what might they think about me or my intentions? Okay. So here's the six styles. I'll just go over this with you. So the first one, upper left, is reaching out with stiff arms, hunched shoulders, and tight chest. Okay, so there's certain rigidity in that. Okay, see what that's like. This one, reaching out by leaning forward with head and neck in front of your shoulders, arms all stretched out. Okay, like really diving in, reaching forward. The next one, reaching out halfway with hunched shoulders, arms pinned to your side, head and neck pulled in, and eyes cast downward. Okay, so not even making eye contact, you know, your arms not fully out, it's kind of halfway, a little stiff there. What does that feel like? Okay, next one, bottom left, reaching out with palms sideways, eyes averted, head down into the side. Okay, you could almost feel the ambivalence in that one, right? This one, all right, reaching out with palm up, eye contact, chin level, and spine aligned. Ah, okay, a little more confidence there, right? And then the last one, reaching out with palm down, stiff arm, and upper body pulling back. Okay, so there's a reaching out and a pulling back at the same time. Okay, so try that, see what that feels like. Okay, all right, so this one, this exercise is called executing proximity seeking actions. Okay. So this is something that, you know, you would want to try with somebody. Okay. So in the presence of someone you trust, perhaps a therapist, if you have one, otherwise, maybe a friend who would like to do these exercises with you, maybe both could do them for mutual benefit. Okay. So you're going to practice reaching out to each other and see what that, in different ways. You could try different styles and see what that feels like. You could practice trying to create proximity by leaning toward the person. You could experiment with different amounts of leaning toward, like maybe just a tiny bit, or maybe just a little bit more and see what that feels like. And then you can go back to the way you were and maybe try leaning toward again, see how that feels. You could experiment with different kinds of eye contact, you know, and see what that feels like. Okay, so after you do each one, And you could do each one, you know, in a variety of ways. Notice how your building blocks are impacted. Okay, so how does it affect your emotions, your thoughts, your body sensations, your movements, or the movements you want to make? And are there any images or memories that come up as you're doing these things, right? Because, you know, they developed in childhood. So if you do things that feel familiar, old images might pop up. Okay, so just notice that and just see what that's all about. All right. Okay, so this is the last exercise, but there's multiple parts, okay? And you also need a therapist or a trusted friend with you to do these exercises, okay? It's a two-person scenario. Okay, so you and your partner are gonna stand in a room at least 10 feet apart, okay? And face one another. And so now with your arm or your hand, make a motion beckoning that person to walk toward you, all right? And the person should advance toward you very slowly, like very slowly, one step at a time, really, really take their time so you could notice how your building blocks are impacted as they come closer. So in particular, notice any body sensations you experience as they advance toward you, okay? So if you feel an internal change that makes you feel, you sense that the person's too close, you wanna put your hand out and make a stop motion, and then your partner needs to stop. That's part of the exercise. They have to listen to you, okay? So just tune into yourself, and if you get like some kind of a twinge that it doesn't feel right, just put your hand out and make the person stop, okay? And then ask the person to back away from you again. And this time tune into yourself and notice when they feel too far away, okay? Because that might feel a certain way with your body also, okay? But again, this has to be done very slowly so you can really track it, okay? And so you could try this a few times. You could, you know, practice beckoning and having them come closer and then stopping and then having them retreat and just noticing how it feels when they come closer and further away. And try to figure out what's the distance that feels right for you, that feels the most comfortable, where you're in the most window of tolerance, you know, comfortable arousal, at ease feeling, okay? What's the right proximity, okay? And what are the body sensations that give you the clue that it's the right proximity, right? You feel a certain degree of like relaxation, the, you know, feeling you can make easy eye contact. Do you feel more relaxed and open in your body? What's the clues for you that gives you the sense that this is an okay distance? All right. All right. So then using this, you know, exercise, what you learn from it, as you go through your week, notice in your interactions with people when they feel too close, when they feel too far, and when they feel just right. Just like Goldilocks and the Three Bears. Well, kind of like that. Okay. So this is going to kind of take it into your real life and, you know, help you negotiate, you know, proximity and distance. Okay. All right. So there you go. So I hope this was helpful for you guys. If you want to learn more about your attachment styles, I have videos on all four of the attachment styles. And I believe I have a playlist where they're all in there. So it's easy to find. So feel free to explore that also to help you further with this exercise. But, you know, give it a try. It could really help your relationships and work through some old implicit memories that might be holding you back from approaching others and, you know, gaining the closeness and connection that you really want. All right. Well, thanks for listening, you guys, and I'll see you soon. Okay. Bye.